Europe, actually like America, likes to introduce itself as a receptive, different, and multicultural mainland. Yet, numerous individuals in and outside of Europe use European as an equivalent word for white. Dark Europe is scarcely present in standard stories of the mainland's set of experiences and culture, notwithstanding hundreds of years of imperialism entrapping the destinies of African individuals and their European colonizers. Thus, numerous Afro-Europeans who've lived in Europe for ages frequently feel like their nation of origin doesn't have a spot for them. As a British-conceived black child from Sheffield, creator Johny Pitts encountered this sensation of removal himself. He frequently felt compelled to distinguish either as British European or as black, however never as both. That is the thing that enlivened Johny to set out on an excursion to the core of black Europe. Going through Paris, Brussels, and Moscow, he needed to encounter for himself how black history and culture have molded Europe. On his excursion, he met Surinamese Dutch activists, Congolese specialists, and black French aggressors. He found a rich mosaic of black scholars, laborers, and activists who were producing another character for themselves, Afropean. In these sections, you'll learn how Africans and black Americans observed blackness in 1920s Paris, how a Surinamese public venue in Amsterdam is protecting black history, and how Afropeans in Lisbon have made a very close local area. Chapter 1 in Sheffield, Johny saw his multicultural area disintegrate under financial pressing factors. As a child, creator Johny Pitts didn't ponder what it intended to be black in Europe. His father was a black American artist from Brooklyn, and his mother came from a white, average British family with Irish roots. The two had met during the 1960s when Johnny's dad was visiting Britain with his contraband band, the Fantastic Temptations. They, in the long run, settled down in Sheffield, where Johny was conceived. In any case, in Firth Park, the zone where Johny grew up, his blended legacy wasn't too strange. Firth Park is a common area in Sheffield. It began as a lodging project for foreigner laborers from British states in the late 19th century. Today, it's comprised of a blend of those specialists' relatives, white common families, second-age migrants from Yemen, India, and Jamaica, and, all the more as of late, evacuees from Syria, Somalia, and Kosovo. Johny recollects Firth Park as a harsh yet lively, dynamic, and racially lenient area. From the window of his youth room, he noticed large numbers of the multicultural shows and comedies that worked out in the city underneath, from Yemeni weddings and reggae gatherings to pack shootings and medication bargains. It was this climate that, from the 1970s to the 1990s, made Firth Park a problem area for perhaps the main black social developments, hip jump. His white companion Leon and his Yemeni companion Muhammad acquainted Johny with the black underground hip bounce culture of Sheffield, which included unlawful square gatherings and the privateer radio broadcast SCR. In any case, by the mid-1990s, when Johny was a youngster, the dynamic social and social life in Firth Park had started to disintegrate. Globalization and streamlined commerce had disintegrated a significant number of the nearby ventures that the regular workers and outsider networks depended on. Under this expanding financial tension, a demeanor of despondency and distress started to crawl into life at Firth Park. A large number of the companions Johny grew up with ended up caught in crippling neediness and went to liquor, medications, and wrongdoing. Sheffield had once given Johny a pleased, multicultural common personality. This changed after his examinations in London. He progressively felt that he had neither a spot operating at a profit black and brown people group he'd experienced childhood in nor in the greater part white country that dismissed them. He started to think about what it intended to be black and European, and particularly what it intended to be both simultaneously. He concluded that the best way to respond to these inquiries was to go exploring across the mainland and discover for himself. Chapter 2 Paris uncovered the profound chronicled associations between Europe, Africa, and Black America. Outside of networks like Firth Park, Black Europeans can appear to be undetectable. Many are first or second-age migrants from previous European provinces like Mozambique and Ghana. They work long and odd hours as cleaners, cabbies, or safety officers. Furthermore, many live concealed in lodging projects at the edges of their urban areas. This makes the fantasy that there's nothing of the sort as dark Europe. But it took just one stop in Paris to persuade Johny that this is a significant misguided judgment. Aside from London, Paris is perhaps the blackest city in Europe. Quarters like Barbes Rochechouart and Chateau Rouge are home to a different African people group, bragging a rich woven artwork, Moroccan shops, Senegalese cafes, and Pan-African craftsmanship exhibitions. The associations between these African people group and France run profound, not least, obviously, in light of French expansionism. Celebrated French creator Alexandre Dumas, for instance, who composed works of art like The Three Musketeers, was Afropean. His grandma was a subjugated lady from the previous French settlement of Haiti, purchased by a French blue blood in the late 18th century. In any case, Paris additionally has some surprising associations with Black America. During the First World War, the U.S. Army positioned an African-American unit named the Harlem Hellfighters in France. These warriors acquainted French individuals with Black American culture, jazz music, particularly. Before the finish of the conflict, Parisians had gained a specific preference for African American culture and the other way around. Simultaneous with the Harlem Renaissance in New York, the 1930s Negritude development drew popular Black Americans like author Richard Wright and artist Josephine Baker to Paris. They were joined by craftsmen and savvy people from previous French settlements, for example, essayist Aimé Césaire from Martinique and Senegalese writer Léopold Sédar Senghor. Together, these early Afropean progressives tried observing blackness as the zenith of craftsmanship and excellence. Unearthing a road fight during his visit, Johny startlingly wound up among their advanced beneficiaries. Dark Parisians from varying backgrounds were fighting the French parfumier Jean-Paul Guerlain, who'd quite recently boldly utilized the N-word on public TV. The way that Guerlain felt agreeable enough to utilize the slur features a more profound issue of prejudice and racial unfairness, which has gone unchecked in France for such a long time. The bigoted remark dehumanized and made undetectable the existences of many Black Parisians, individuals like ongoing North and West African foreigners, who are compelled to live in poor people, sequestered banlieues at the edges of Paris, and who work low-paying, frequently hard work occupations. Chapter 3: Brussels Black People Group spearheaded the new Afropean personality. Brussels, Johny's next stop, was once cast a ballot, Europe's most exhausting capital. But the perfect, administrative surface of the city shrouds an especially severe part of Afropean history. Belgium's pioneer rule in the Congo in the mid-20th century killed more than 10 million Congolese individuals. During a visit to the Royal Museum of Central Africa Museum in the edges of Brussels, Johny acknowledged how little Belgium has dealt with its provincial past. The historical center was worked for King Leopold II's World Fair in 1897, which opened with a live display of 267 Congolese individuals dispatched from Africa. Today, the gallery has a dusty assortment of relics from Belgium's pioneer rule, scarcely contextualized by cutting-edge explainers. Indeed, even Brussels' touristy downtown area is checkered with tokens of colonialist purposeful publicity. In a shop devoted to popular Belgian illustrator Hergé, Johny discovered a comic book named Tintin in the Congo from 1931. This Tintin experience includes the adored primary character making a trip to the Congo, where he experiences a few gross, bigoted cartoons of Africans, poaches innumerable wild creatures, and styles himself as the white hero. This very late piece of colonialist publicity, which Hergé didn't repudiate until 1970, advantageously overlooks the way that the genuine purpose behind Belgium's attack of the Congo was to misuse the country's rich assets of ivory and elastic, in quite possibly the most severe and rough cycles to date. From inside the colonialist tradition of Belgium, the contemporary thought of Afropeanism was birthed. It was Belgian-Congolese vocalist Marie Dalne who initially utilized the term to portray her music project with Talking Heads artist David Byrne, which consolidates African and European impacts. Byrne later portrayed Dalne's music as an inconspicuous pronouncement for another, all-encompassing Black European character. The African people group in the locale of Matonge in Brussels gives more models that typify what Afropean life resembles. There, you'll discover a blend of Congolese, Rwandese and Senegalese eateries, boutiques, secondhand shops, and jazz clubs. Meandering between these diverse African people groups in Brussels, you'll experience many Black social migrants like Johny, who feel like they don't have a place with any class, race, or country specific. and who are joined in this ease. Chapter 4 In Amsterdam, youthful Afro-Surinamese activists are saving the tradition of African-American progressives. Did you realize that the New York area's Brooklyn, Harlem, and Bedford-Stuyvesant are completely named after Dutch urban communities? Like Paris, the Netherlands and its capital, Amsterdam, have profound authentic associations with New York, a significant number of which go through Amsterdam's Black People Group. The Netherlands' greatest ethnic minority are the Afro-Surinamese, relatives of oppressed West Africans brought over in pilgrim times. Even though the Netherlands inclines toward the common European amnesia with regards to their colonialist pasts, Afro-Surinamese individuals in Amsterdam have figured out how to shape an unmistakable and gladly political local area throughout the long term. They assumed a part in the Harlem Renaissance of New York during the 1930s, upheld the Surinamese freedom development of the 1970s, and contributed to the spread of global Marxist legislative issues in the 20th century. A cutting-edge center point of the Afro-Surinamese people group, the Hugo Olijveld House, sits directly in the center of Amsterdam's shady area of town. It was taken over by Suriname's most established affiliation, On Suriname, during the 1970s. Today, it's a multifunctional public venue, which fills in as a grassroots getting sorted out space and DIY imaginative studio. Among different activists, it has the New Urban Collective, an eccentric women's activist organization of Afro-Dutch understudies attempting to protect Black history. Their Black archives contain a great many works of significant Black scholars, from Jamaican writer Claude McKay to American social equality pioneer W.E.B. Du Bois. The document likewise contains the failure to remember the tradition of Dutch-American progressives Otto and Hermina Huswoud. Brought into the world in British and Dutch Guiana, the Huswouds met in Harlem, where they were invited into a flourishing scene of Black scholarly people and creatives. Otto later turned into the primary Black establishing individual from the American Socialist Coalition, and surprisingly met Lenin in Moscow. In any case, when against socialist slant started to spread in the U.S. after the Second World War, he was ousted. He utilized his Dutch visa to relocate to Amsterdam, and Hermina followed before long. There, the couple immediately steered at On Suriname and transformed the Afro-Surinamese Association into a vehicle that upheld communist legislative issues. The New Urban Collective endeavors to safeguard the accounts of Afro-Surinamese activists like the Huswouds to politicize and prepare Dutch Afropeans in the present. For instance, they've assumed the main part in the new fights against Zwarte Piet, a bigoted personification from a kid's Christmas story that Dutch individuals demand celebrating by sprucing up in blackface during the happy season. Chapter 5 Berlin is home to a whitewashed enemy of extremist development, and a flourishing Rastafarian people group. At the point when Johny looked into his lodging in Berlin, the secretary disclosed to him that he was going to experience a monstrous city brimming with wonderful, open individuals. Indeed, to Johny, Berlin in winter showed up very unforgiving and unpleasant, and when he needed to join an enemy of the extremist exhibition in the downtown area, he initially thought he'd incidentally run into a gathering of skinheads. However, he immediately discovered that the 4,000 or so unruly glancing young people in dim garments were individuals from the Antifa, a worldwide enemy of fundamentalist association with establishes in Nazi opposition developments. The alleged point of the Antifa walk Johny participated in Berlin was to remember Silvio Meyer, an individual from the local area who was executed by a Nazi posse in 1992. All things being equal, however, it appeared to be that the occasion was for the most part about impacting music, drinking lager, and getting into minor battles with the police. Johny saw that even though they were fighting the fundamentalist and bigoted savagery straightforwardly influencing Germany's minority networks, practically the entirety of the walk's members were youthful and white. As in numerous other European nations, prejudice is as yet a common, and surprisingly destructive, issue in Germany. Since the fall of the Berlin Wall, more than 130 individuals have been slaughtered in racially roused assaults in Germany. Among these assaults were the scandalous National Socialist Underground (NSU) murders during the 2000s, in which 10 German-Turkish individuals were slaughtered. At the Sudanese Café Nil in Berlin Friedrichshain, Johny found a local area that fit him better. Here, he met the so-called Black Prophet Muhammad, who welcomed Him to the public venue, nightclub, and youth focus YAAM, the Young African Artist Market. YAAM, Johny learned, was the multicultural heart of Berlin's enormous Rastafarian people group. Rastafari Makanan was an Ethiopian imperial of the mid-20th century. He was instructed by a French Capuchin priest as a youngster and later turned into the Emperor of Ethiopia. His common, strategic, and communist principle enlivened another strict development in Jamaica that consolidated fundamentals from Christianity, African legends, Black Force legislative issues, and Pan-Africanism. In Berlin, Johny found that Rastafarianism, which addresses the crossing point of these convictions and belief systems, had been taken up by white Germans and West African settlers the same, large numbers of whom would meet at YAAM. This blissful conflict of societies helped Johny to remember Afro-German artist Mayayim, who once stated, "I will be African regardless of whether you need me to be German, and I will be German regardless of whether my obscurity sometimes falls short for you." Chapter 6 Stockholm flaunts numerous Afropean examples of overcoming adversity, however, can be oblivious to the underlying foundations of racial treachery. To numerous individuals, Scandinavian nations like Sweden address a sort of European ideal world, a decent government-backed retirement framework, free medical care and schooling, and a reformist, open-minded culture. For Johny, Sweden was a shelter from the racial pressures pervasive in numerous other European nations. From TV hosts to culinary specialists to artists like Nena Cherry and Quincy Jones III, Swedish media is populated by numerous fruitful black individuals, some with traveler foundations. As per Johny, the open and open-minded climate in Sweden is advanced by their communist way of thinking of folkhemmet, which urges Swedes to see their country as one, major family. Yet, even lenient Sweden utilizes a questionable twofold awareness with regards to issues of racial equity. Salah, a bouncer from Tunisia who Johny met at his Swedish inn, summarized it along these lines: individuals in Europe, they think they give settlers some help. But we are just here because they annihilate our nations. Furthermore, he's not off base. Unbeknownst to many, Sweden is as of now the third biggest arms exporter on the planet, directly behind Russia and Israel. The majority of these weapons, which have energized battles in the Middle East, just as military upsets in Africa, are made by the previous Swedish vehicle organization, Saab. Furthermore, instead of finding out about and defying this obscure reputation, Johny saw that a portion of the accomplished Swedish Afropeans would in general chide later black migrants for apparently putting forth little attempt to follow Swedish social and social assumptions. For instance, Lucille, an Afro-Cuban-Swedish understudy, voiced her anxiety that numerous youngsters presently talked in Rinkeby Swedish, the slang of Sweden's biggest worker area. Rinkeby is an assortment of tedious, dark, tall structures like other lodging projects for Europe's poor, foreigner regular workers. Quite a long time ago, Sweden's communist Prime Minister Olof Palme had supported driven designs to furnish worker networks with lodging, public spaces, schools, and libraries. However, after Palm died in 1986 and the ascent of worldwide corporatism, a large number of these tasks were relinquished, and settlers were driven farther from the city. Remarking on this, British writer Owen Hatherley once composed that in Stockholm, social vote-based system was deserted distinctly for poor people, its developments were held for the bourgeoisie. Chapter 7 Present-day Moscow bears a little hint of the Soviet Union's old multicultural beliefs. Of the multitude of spots he'd anticipated making a trip to, Johny was least amped up for going to Moscow. Lately, Russia has seen an ascent in bigoted assaults against outsiders, particularly African understudies. At the point when he'd applied for a visa in London, even the assistant at the Russian department cautioned Johny not to walk alone around evening time. However, Russia wasn't in every case such an unpleasant spot for black individuals. For instance, perhaps the main figures of current Russian writing, Alexander Pushkin, were of African drop. His extraordinary granddad Abram Gannibal was brought into the world in Ethiopia, abducted and oppressed by the Ottomans, and later offered to Count Peter Tolstoy. In another model, Paul Robeson, an African-American entertainer, an artist who ventured out to Moscow on a shoot during the 1930s, were excited by how deferentially he was treated by the white regular workers of the Soviet Union. Here, he wrote in his journal, "I'm a person. Beyond a shadow of a doubt, the Soviet Union's socialist philosophy encouraged fortitude between Russia's white average workers and black obstruction developments around the globe. In the battle against Western government, persecution, and misuse, the Soviet Union adjusted itself to the social equality development in the U.S., just as numerous African freedom developments. From the 1950s to the 1980s, it even urged African understudies to learn at Russian colleges. Thusly, numerous African and Black American pioneers felt for communist and socialist belief systems. Western forces retaliated against these collusions energetically. American knowledge organizations were engaged with killing an enormous number of Black and communist pioneers around the planet, from Martin Luther King Jr. in the U.S. to Olof Palme in Sweden to the Congo's first fairly chosen PM, Patrice Lumumba. In the long run, and apparently, the West won. The Soviet Union imploded in 1991, and its mutual, multicultural soul began to disappear. New Russian pioneers like Vladimir Putin energized a flood of patriotism, xenophobia, and homophobia. What's more, presently, a considerable lot of the excess African understudies routinely experience clear bigotry from white Russian individuals, to the point that they don't wander a long ways past the grounds of the city colleges. A long ways from the multicultural standards of the past, African understudies enlisted at the People's Friendship University of Moscow today live a chilly, discouraging presence, sharing their grounds at the edges of the city with neighborhood drug addicts and heavy drinkers. Chapter 8 In Marseille, Johny tracked down a little Afropean ideal world. Bringing his excursion round trip, Johny ventured out from Russia back to France. This time, he took a train around Provence, halting a couple of times to respect a portion of the wonderful manors along the coast. A large number of these rich structures are relics from provincial occasions, and, pretty much in a real sense, inundated with the blood of African individuals. The Villa Leopolda in the seaside town Villefranche-sur-Mer, for instance, the most costly manor on the planet, was worked by Belgian King Leopold II with his Congolese blood cash. What's more, the Villa del Mare in Roquebrune-Cap-Martin once had a place with Congolese military authority Joseph Mobutu, who schemed with Belgium and the U.S. to kill Congolese Prime Minister Patrice Lumumba. One of the old French estates, nonetheless, was home to a genuine black symbol, James Baldwin. James Baldwin was brought into the world in New York and got quite possibly the main authors of the American social liberties development. But since of his homosexuality, he was avoided as much as possible by numerous other black scholars of the time. During the 1940s, he escaped to Paris and turned out to be essential for the negritude development, before settling down in the waterfront town St. Paul de Vence. Until his demise in 1987, he utilized his little manor to engage black superstars like Frantz Fanon, Richard Wright, Nina Simone, and Maya Angelou. For a poor, gay, black man from New York, he'd accomplished an unimaginable accomplishment. He was experiencing the French dream. Another sort of French dream is remarkable in contemporary Marseille, a mechanical harbor city not a long way from Baldwin's old home. As a port associating Europe to North Africa, Marseille has generally been a position of movement, multiculturalism, and common legislative issues. It's likewise the site of world-acclaimed workmanship and writing. Dumas' The Three Musketeers, for instance, is set in Marseille. What's more, in his 1929 novel Banjo, Jamaican artist Claude McKay caught the debaucherous excellence of the city through the eyes of a youthful African hero. Right up till the present time, Marseille is home to numerous North Africans from Algeria, Morocco, and Tunisia, who effectively exist together with huge white common laborers, and, all the more as of late, settlers from Romania, as well. The city's simple, mutual common soul promptly spoke to Johny. As far as he might be concerned, Marseille was the Afropean Bohemia he'd been searching for. Chapter 9 In Lisbon, Afropeans from previous Portuguese states have constructed their little world. Of the multitude of urban areas he'd visited, multicultural, common Marseille had come nearest to his fantasy of Afropea, a diverse however interconnected local area of African Europeans and European Africans, where individuals, narratives, and societies converge to remain against bigotry, despotism, and financial misuse. In Lisbon, he found another illustration of this sort of intercultural, average fortitude. Large numbers of Portugal's Afropeans have establishes in the previous Portuguese settlements of Mozambique, Cape Verde, and Angola. Bidirectional migration between the two mainlands during frontier times has obscured the lines between the European and African personalities. Johny's Lisbon Control Nino, for instance, has a black mother who recognizes as Portuguese and a white dad from Mozambique who was ousted after the nation's freedom. Large numbers of these Afropeans live in a piece of Lisbon called Cova de Moura, an illicit settlement of incapacitated, low-ascent structures suggestive of a Brazilian favela. Nino cautioned that Cova de Moura was an off-limits area for most untouchables, and in any event, for the nearby police. However, with Nino's companion Jacare close by, Johny found an energetic and brilliant region, one with kids playing in the city, and dividers canvassed in paintings of black symbols like Nelson Mandela. Jacare clarified that despite the destitution and wrongdoing, individuals wouldn't leave if they could. At the point when they visited the public venue Associação Cultural de Juventude in the core of Cova de Moura, Johny got why. The affiliation, which was set up during the 1980s, capacities as a youngster's library, place for ladies' privileges, residence council authority, recording studio, and a whole lot more. At the point when they showed up, a neighborhood band was playing live Afrobeat music, while occupants were breaking out their best Cape Verdean dance moves and drinking modest brew. Cova de Moura's exuberant, bubbly road culture was the remainder of many hid Afropean accounts Johny revealed on his excursion. After Lisbon, Johny made a beeline for his last stop, Gibraltar, the British island off the shore of Spain. On a sunny morning, you can see the shores of Africa from the island's Europa Point. When Johny showed up, however, it was too shady to even think about seeing more than a couple of yards ahead. In any case, after the entirety of his movements, he wanted to see Africa from a far distance. All things considered, he'd effectively seen it from very close in numerous edges of Europe. The different African people group across Europe persuaded Johny that Afropea didn't simply have a past, it likewise had an energetic present and a cheerful future. Afropean, Notes from Black Europe by Johny Pitt's book review African American populations in Europe are an imperative piece of the mainland's set of experiences and culture. Over and over again, these networks are avoided about European public accounts, are distraught by financial pressing factors, and are delivered undetectable in progressively improved urban communities. Even though the strings of imperialism run profound all through European culture, numerous nations presently can't seem to, as expected, deal with their frontier past and its consequences for African individuals. Yet, regardless of this, Afropeans have figured out how to make dynamic and rich networks everywhere on the landmass, from extremist associations in Amsterdam to Rastafari clubs in Berlin to public venues in Lisbon.